Okay, thank you everyone. Thank you Francesco again for organizing everything, and Manu as well. So that's the last lecture. If you've been able to make it up to here, it's pretty good. And so so today it's going to be roughly the same idea than last time when I was talking about Artifact and post-Artifact methods. From the computational perspective, here I'm going to talk today about the GW approach and the Bethe-Salpeter equation formalism as well. So it's going to be much more applied than Xavier's cours and Matteo's cours. But I'm going to focus more on not the equations mainly, but how to code them and what they mean in terms of, let's say, n-wavy physics, okay? So there is no demonstration and so on, but I refer you to the previous lectures if you want to any more details about those equations, okay? So again, feel free to stop me at any time. If you have any question, I would be very happy to try to answer them. And so that's it, okay? Okay, so today's program, so there is basically three parts. I've tried to slice them nicely, but might be a little bit of overlap between them. So hopefully we have enough time to go to the last section. I'm not too sure about this because that's the first time I give this lecture, but we'll see. And so we're going to start to talk so the charge excitations and the different flavors of GW, because they're not, sadly, there is not only one GW method, there is an entire family of them. So we need to talk about each of them and the specificities in terms of implementation and computational cost and convergence as well. And when we've done this, so we'll talk about neutral excitations. So charge excitations is an excitation where you modify the number of electrons in the system. So an ionization potential and an electron affinity, for example, you remove and you add one electron. So that's what we call charge excitations for the chemist. And neutral excitations, that's what you call optical excitations as well, where you have a fixed number of electrons in your system, okay? So basically it's like an excitation in a molecule where you excite from one singlet state to the next singlet state, which usually we call the optical. So we'll talk about this afterwards, okay? So there is a bunch of acronyms here that have been defined. So if you can't remember an acronym, you can come back to that slide and have a look. But there is lots of them. I'm going to try to introduce them step by step, okay? And so the last part, so hopefully we'll talk about how to compute the correlation energy at this level of theory. So at the GW or BSC level of theory using different approaches, okay? Okay, so a little bit of context. What are we going to talk about today? So I'm going to start by fixing the notation. So we are sure that everybody's talking about the same thing. So here I'm going to deal with a finite system, molecules basically, or atoms if you want. So I'm going to assume that I have a closed shell system. So closed shell system means what? Means that you have two opposite spin electrons per orbitals, okay? So you don't have like unpaired electrons and so on. So there is no radicals and so on. So you can generalize all the equations that I'm going to give today. You can generalize this to open shell system, but I'm not going to talk about this today because it's too technical and I don't think it will be very wise from a pedagogical point of view if you want. So we're going to deal with singlet excited state, okay? So what I mean by this is that when you're going to excite an electron, so we're not going to take into account the spin flip of this electron. So we're going to make sure that we conserve the spin of the electron when it excites. But again, you can generalize that to triplet states where you have a flip And so again, all those equations can be generalized to triplet states. So again, I'm not going to talk about it because, I mean, it would be more general, but I think it will be more confusing than anything else. So I'm dealing with singlet excited state, but remember that we can generalize that to triplets, no problem, okay? So during the entire lecture, I'm going to use the same notation, hopefully. And so O is the number of occupied orbitals, okay? So most of the equations today are going to be in the molecular orbital basis already. So we're going to deal with the basis function a little bit. So the atomic orbital, we're not going to talk about it too much, okay? So V is going to be the number of vacant orbitals. So vacant means unoccupied or virtual orbitals, okay? And N, which is equal to O plus V, is the total number of orbitals, okay? So phi p is going to be a real spatial orbital, okay? So we don't deal with complex orbitals here. It's for closed shell molecules. It's probably best to talk only about real spatial orbitals, okay? When you see ijkl, usually it's occupied orbitals. A, B, C, D is going to be vacant orbitals. And when I use pqrs, it means that they can be either occupied or vacant. So these two general orbitals. And sometimes if you see mu, nu, lambda, sigma, it's basically indices for the basis functions for the atomic orbitals, okay? But you shouldn't see it too much today. So I've tried to use exactly the same notation as the previous lecture. So normally if you followed the previous one, you should be able to follow easily this one today. And last, M, an index that you're going to see a lot, is the number of single excitations in the system. So from I to A, for example, from an occupied to a virtual one. And so there is obviously O times V of, okay? So that's all the notation, basically. Okay, so I'm giving you here, I'm going to put like a few references, but it's hard to be exhaustive in those kind of presentations. So here is a bunch of, I'd say, interesting papers for you if you are at least a chemist and if you want to learn the, let's say, the chemical notations. So it's all those papers are basically deals with molecules, except maybe the book there. But so there is the very nice paper by Fabien Brunvan, where he actually described his implementation of GW with Gaussian basis sets. And so that's his software that he called MolGW. Very, very nice paper. And there is also a very similar implementation by Van Setten and coworkers. That's the implementation that you're going to find in TurboMol. And that's also based on Gaussian basis functions, okay? There is, of course, Fiesta, who is the software developed by Xavier Blas and Yvan Duchemin in Grenoble. Where again, they use a Gaussian basis function, and you can read that review if you want to have more details about their implementation. And there is the FHI Ames implementation, so by the Fritz Haber Institute in Berlin, I think. That's the paper that basically gives the details of the implementation. So they don't use Gaussian orbitals here, they use what they call numerical orbitals, numerical basis functions. So, and so they don't do only like GW, but they do what we fully self-consistent GW. And so we're not going to talk about it today because it's quite specific and more expensive. But if you want to learn about it, please have a look to that paper. In terms of reviews and books, so here is a bunch of reviews, like five of them which are more or less for specialists, I'd say. Some of them are very, very general. Some of them are very, very specific. So have a look to that list. And there is, of course, the book of Martin Lucharaini and Seperli, Interacting Electron, which is a very nice book, which deal more with solid state systems. But I mean, it's nicely written, and there is plenty of physics in there and interesting stuff. If in the future you do research, method development on GW type approach, you might be interested to know that there is a type of data set of ionization potential for a set of 100 molecules that has been designed by Van Seten, and that's what we call the GW100 data set. And so there is a very nice website. The address is here, where you can find all the reference data and make graphs for you if you want to compare methods and compare different type of implementation and so on. So if you are interested to code in GW one day or beta salpeter, it might be a very good idea to have a look at this website, where you can find plenty of information and as well and data that you can compare. Okay. So I probably forgot lots of them, but I'm sorry in advance, but I think that's a subset, but hopefully it's a nice subset. Okay. So in terms of when we do a GW calculation or a beta salpeter calculation, so what are we doing? Okay, so Matteo Gatti said that very well last week, is that GW and beta salpeter are doing physically two different things. Okay. So the GW calculation is going to be here to compute what we call quasi-particle energy, which corresponds to charge excitations. So basically, you're going to calculate IPs, ionization potential, and electron affinities, EAs, okay? That's what you're doing, okay? So for example, if you take the difference of the IP and the EA, you get what we call the fundamental gap, okay? So that's what we call the band gap in a solid, okay, which corresponds to excite an electron in the conducting band, okay. And so if you were doing a DFT calculation, you would calculate that as the difference between the LUMO and the HOMO orbitals, okay. So that's what we call the Kohn-Sham gap, which is here, which is usually sadly which lover estimate badly sometimes the true fundamental gap, which is here, okay. And so by doing a GW calculation, physically what you're going to do, you're going to correct that Kohn-Sham gap to make it basically much closer to the exact one, okay. So that here is going to be a calculation based on the one body Green's function. Why? Because you're dealing with one electron excitation, okay. You're going to remove an electron from the system or add an electron to the system. So it's a one body physical process. So you deal with the one body Green's function. That's GW. Okay. Second step is going to deal with when you have excited your electron here. Of course, you've left behind a hole. Okay. This hole is positively charged, okay, and it's going to interact with the electron that you have excited. So that's what we call the electron hole attraction, okay, or excitonic effect, okay, which is a positive quantity because it's going to stabilize the system, okay, a negative quantity, so it stabilizes the system, okay, and that's what we call the excitonic effect. So if you take the fundamental gap and you remove the excitonic effect, you're going to end up with what we call the optical gap, okay? The optical gap usually is defined as the energy difference between the lowest singlet excited state and the ground state, okay? So E1 minus E0, okay? So you see that the optical gap usually is smaller than the fundamental gap. Why? Because you have an attraction between the electron and the hole left behind. And so that's definitely a two electron process, okay? You have the electron and the hole. So you're going to deal with the two particle Green's function, and that's where you're going to use beta salpeter to get that effect, okay? So basically you can see GW for a method to get charge excitations, and basically BAC as a method to actually correct that fundamental gap to give you the right optical gap by taking into account this electron hole attraction. Okay, that's really the physics, the basic physics behind it. Okay. Hope it's clear for everyone. If you have any questions, please shoot them now. Okay. So what are you going to be able to calculate with a GW calculation? Basically, IPs from the occupied orbitals that you're going to correct, okay? So you start with Kunshan eigenvalues on orbitals, and you're going to correct them to be able to calculate IPs and EAs from the virtual energies, okay? Yes, so it really gives you a correction on top of your input Kunshan eigenvalues. So if you take the difference of those quantities, you can get the fundamental gap, okay, the bond gap in solids, okay, it's just differences. You can also calculate correlation of total energies, and we're going to talk about it at the end of this presentation. PSE, you're going to calculate different quantities, okay, as we said, you're going to complete singlet and triplet optical excitation. Okay, so it's really vertical absorption energies, okay? So you excite an electron, but you keep the geometry of the molecule at the geometry of the ground state. So it's important to understand that you freeze the geometry during the excitation process. It's very important. So that's going to frequencies. So in nanometer, EV, or whatever units you want, depending on your field of frequency. But you can also compute optical, okay? Just basically absorption intensities. And also at sea level, you can compute correlation and energies, okay? So as mentioned by Xavier weeks ago, when you're doing GW calculation, what you're doing is you're basically iterating that this pentagon here, basically Eddin's pentagon. And so you're going to compute in principle G, you to bypass the computation of the vex function because it's complicated. That's the definition of GW. Don't compute gamma, gamma is equal to one. And based on G, I'm going to calculate polarizability. And when I have the polarizability, I compute the dynamically screened Coulomb potential, okay? And basically when I have G and W by a convolution, we compute sigma, which is given by D, and because gamma equal one, this gives you sigma GW, which is basically the name of the method. That's why it's called like this. And I have sigma, I can correct Kunshan energy, sorry, and can use the screening and those correct eigenvalues, quasi-particles, sorry, to do my BSE calculation. Or depending on what we want, I want to do, I can keep iterating this pentagon. It's what we call self-consistent GW approach. Okay, until I'm satisfied quantities are converged, and after I can go out this time. Okay, so if I do one turn around the, well, no, it's not a pentagon anymore, it's a square. That it's called a G0W0, G0W0 calculation. So it's one shot calculation. I do not iterate. And if you go around this many times, so that's what we call partially self-consistent or self-consistent GW approach. And you have eigenvalue GW like EVGW or quasi particle self-consistent GW, which is QSGW. Okay, and so we're going to talk about all these approaches afterwards in details, okay? So that's the chain of action. If you do many body perturbation theory, you're always going to do, if you want to do a better Salpeter calculation, you're going to have to code up a few things. The first thing is basically to be able to code a Kunshan calculation. So you have to code Kunshan, DFT, okay, or R-trifold. You can use those quantities to do a GW approximation. It's going to be able to give you a good fundamental gap, okay? Actually better than DFT. Based on this, based on this GW calculation, you're going to be able to do a better Salpeter equation calculation, which will allow you to grab the excitonic effect and you're going to be able to compute neutral excitation of your systems. Okay, and so those two processes correspond to two different spectroscopies. Okay, and this one electron and two electron processes. Okay, or one particle, two particle, I should say. Sorry. So N-wavy stuff are pretty much done. So that's basically what we're going to try to do today. So I just want to remind you something, because that's a mistake that we see often in papers, and I think every student should know that, is that when you do photochemistry, of course, during the excitations, you can freeze the geometry, but you can also relax the geometries, and we have vibrational levels as well. And so when you excite, you're not going to end up most of the time in the lowest vibrational state and so on, and have a different transition to singlet state, but also to triplet state, and we have different type of spectroscopy and different type of states. Okay, so very 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 simply, okay, so usually what you do is that you take your molecule. And if you have done things well, at least, normally you have optimized your ground state geometry. Okay, so you're here. Okay, and when you're here, so that's the geometry of your system. And when you're here, you're on the ground state. Okay, you've optimized the geometry of the ground state. And when you're going to do a TDDFT calculation or a beta cell beta calculation, what you're going to do is you're going to compute what we call a vertical excitation. So what it means by vertical is that you're not going to move the geometry, okay? So you're going to end up on the excited state, okay? You're going to compute that energy difference, okay? And on the excited state potential curve, there is no guarantee that you are at the minimum of the excited state, okay? So basically what happens next normally is that you're going to relax the excited state, the geometry of the excited state, to end up at the equilibrium geometry corresponding of the excited state. Okay, when you are here, okay, you can as well a vertical energy, this one. So you freeze again, that's vertical excitations energy or de-excitation energy, okay. So that's called fluorescence or emission, and that is called absorption, okay? And that's two different things, okay? So if you take the difference between the vertical, between the absorption and the fluorescence energy, that's what we call the adiabatic energies, okay? But if you want to be able to compare with experiments, okay, you're going to have to add the vibrational correction, which corresponds to the ground state. So you're never going to be at the bottom of the well. There is always the ZPVE, so the 0 point vibrational energy, okay? And you need to compute the one for the excited state as well, okay? And the energy difference between the this bar here, which corresponds to ground state plus 0 point energy, and that one, which is the excited state plus the 0 point energy of the excited state, okay? That's what we call the zero zero energy. And that's the quantity that you're going to calculate experimentally, okay? So if you do a vertical excitation, don't say that it does match the experiment, so my method is good. That's not true. If you do a vertical calculation and you match experiment, it means that you're wrong, because what you are actually calculating experimentally is that zero zero energy, okay, which takes into account the geometrical relaxation of the excited state, and also the ZPV, okay. So normally, if your method match the experimental value, it means that your methods probably underestimate the vertical excitations energy, because that quantity is usually smaller than that quantity here. Okay, so be careful With theory, we don't compute vertical excitation energy. If you want to compare with experiment, you have to compute zero zero energy, which means relaxing the geometry of the excited state, which can be hard, okay, and to take into account the vibrational energies of both the ground state and the excited state. Okay, so be careful about this. There is any question?
Yes. I mean, from me, I just have a question about this. So in standard implementations of GW, are people able to compute gradients and Hessian to really calculate properly?
There is a few papers on this, but not very much. And usually there is always a few approximations.
Okay, so people calculate vertical excitation energies most of the
time. Yes.
Okay. Okay.
So optimizing geometries at the Peter-Salpeter level or GW level, it's hard. So the problem is that we're going to talk about it after, is that actually you compute charge excitations and neutral excitations, but it's not designed to give you total energies. Mm-hmm. And so if you don't have total energies, you have nothing to differentiate to get the gradients. And yep. So to compute equilibrium geometries, you're going to have to do this at some point. Yeah. So there is a few tricks to be able to do it at the GW level and at the BSE level, but that's basically the start at the moment.
Okay, thank you.
For example, Xavier Blas is working on this and they got funding last year or 2 years ago to do it, exactly that. So yeah, that's the start. There is very few papers on this.
Okay, thank you, Titu.
Any other questions so far? No? Keep going? Okay. We are still at 63 people, so good. All right, so we're going to talk about charge excitation, so GW for a start. Okay, so very, very quickly, I'm going to go through the GW equations, Eddings equations. I'm trying to show you how it's done in practice, okay? So you start with G, okay? So G it's a very simple function. You need only the orbitals and their corresponding energy to define that quantity. So the problem with G is that depending on the type of orbitals that you use and their eigenvalues, you can have different name for the Green's function. So you can have the Cohn-Sham-Green's function. You can have the non-interacting Green function. You can have the Hartree-Fock Green function and so on, okay? So you have to be careful about this quantity. So normally you start with Cohn-Sham or non-interacting Green function, okay? When you have this, okay, so you have a removal part, which is basically the IPs, and an addition part, which are the EAs. So you do a convolution of G square, okay? So that's equation 4 to get the polarizability. And when you have the polarizability, you can calculate W through the dielectric function epsilon, okay? So that's really the basic equations. So of course, in a computer, if you don't introduce a basis, you can't do anything, okay? So the first quantity that we want to compute is W, and so I'm going to put that in a basis. So in the orbital basis, okay? So if I've done a Cohn-Sham calculation, it's going to in the basis of the Cohn-Sham orbitals. So WPQRS, okay? Given mistake here, sorry, remove this. So it's given by this, okay? And so you have what we call the exchange part, okay? Which is just a two-electron integral, okay? And that's basically Hartree-Fock exchange. So that's what we call a static quantity, okay? Why? Because it doesn't depend on the frequency, omega, okay? And you have what we call the correlation part of the dynamical screening, okay? And here it's a dynamical quantity because it does depend on the frequency omega, okay? So that's the expression that Matteo Gatti showed you last week, okay? And that's what we need to compute for the Peter-Salpeter calculation at least, okay? So here, PQRS are the usual two electron integrals that we talked about a few weeks ago, okay, in the molecular orbital basis, so be careful. And here, purple screened two electron integrals, PQM, are basically the screened two electron integrals that have screened with some RPAs vectors, okay? And so what do you need to compute W? Basically, is you need to compute the RPA eigenvalues here, the big omega, the capital omega ones, and their eigenvectors. That's what Matteo told you last week, is that in the GW approximation, okay, you're going to compute the screening at the RPA level. Okay, and that's the explicit expression of those quantities here. Okay, so what I'm trying to show you is that if by just doing a standard RPA calculation, you're going to be able to compute through those quantities, okay, W. Okay, and that's exactly what you need in the case of a closed shell system. So how do we do a RPA calculation? So that's what we call a direct RPA calculation. So there is no exchange, it's important. And I'm going to talk about the different flavors of RPA later in this presentation. Okay, so it's a very simple problem, okay? So that's what we call a particle hole RPA, because you are in the basis of single excitation. So you take into account the single excitation from I to A and to J to B, and you build a matrix like this. So what you're going to be to have to do here is to build that matrix, okay, the RPA matrix, with those matrices A and B, and via diagonalization of that matrix, you're going to end up with the eigenvectors and the eigenvalues. Okay, I'm missing RPA here, sorry. Okay. So what you should tell me now is, like, it's horrible because it's a non-Hermitian matrix. So there is absolutely no guarantee that your eigenvalues are going to be real, okay? That could be annoying, okay? And by the way, if you're looking at the expression of the elements of A and B, you see that they are very easy to compute. You just need two electron integrals again and some molecular orbital energies, okay? So that's a non-Hermitian problem. So the size of that problem is 2 times OV, okay? Because that matrix A is of size O times V times O times V, okay? So there is OV single excitation. And you have this B matrix, which has the same size. So this dimension here is 2 times O times V, okay? Same here. So there is a trick, because actually you can show that in certain conditions, that's a pseudo-Hermitian linear problem, which means that you can find the transformation to an equivalent Hermitian problem. Okay, and so that's a very, very well-known trick, is that if you take A plus B and you multiply that left and right by A minus B to the power of half, okay, so actually you can get now it's an Hermitian problem, okay, and so you're going to be able to compute the square root the square of the eigenvalues. So by taking the square root, you get your omega m that you want, and you're going to compute the eigenvectors of that new problem, and you can get back to x and y with those two expressions here, okay, 13 and 14, okay? So it works most of the time, okay? And why is it most of the time? It's because you have to make sure to do this, that A minus B is positive definite, okay? Why is that? It's because if it's not positive definite, it means that some eigenvalues are going to be negative, okay? And remember what we did last time, if you want to take the power of a matrix, you have to diagonalize it first and take the power of the eigenvalues. So if you take the square root of a negative numbers, it's not going to be happy. Okay. So here that matrix is going to be if that matrix is positive definite, you can do this transformation. Okay. And you can do that very efficiently by just doing a usual linear, diagonalization of a symmetric matrix, okay? So if A minus B is not positive definite, okay, that's what we call, that's when you have instabilities, okay? And it can happen actually a lot when you stretch molecules, and that's when you start having unrestricted Konsham solution that are lower in energy than the solution that you have at the start. And so in that case, you won't be able to do your calculation and find another way of doing it. Can be very annoying, okay? So if you have those troubles, you can use one trick, is to use the Tan-Dankov approximation. For example, you say that you're going to set B equal to zero, which is an approximation, but usually it works not so bad. And if you say that B equals zero, you can actually get your eigenvalues, okay? That's what we call the Tan-Dankov approximation, by just diagonalizing the A matrix, okay? And in that case, it's automatically Hermitian and you don't have those problems, okay? So that RPA problem, if you don't have any instabilities, it has particle Hall symmetry, okay? And so basically you're going to get two times O times V eigenvalues, okay? And actually what you get is OV positive eigenvalues and OV negative eigenvalues, and each of the positive eigenvalues correspond to a negative one. So you have a symmetry between the positive and the negative. And that's why you can do this transformation just to compute the square of it, because you have redundancy in your problem, and so you don't have to compute all of them. You just need one set, you need the set of the positive one, which correspond to excitations. You don't want the D excitation, which correspond to the negative eigenvalues, okay? So that's something that is important. We'll talk a little bit about, more about it later on, okay? Any questions so far? Still 63? It's good. No, I'll keep going. Okay. So basically when you have this, and that's basically the first step of any GW calculation, is to compute the screening. So you have to do an RPA calculation. Okay. So you won't be able to do without it. When you have, you can after calculate the infamous self energy, so the GW self energy, which has an exchange part, okay, which is static, okay, and a correlation part, which is omega dependent. So it's a dynamical quantity. It's just the convolution of G and W. Okay, so here is the explicit expression of the exchange contribution of the self energy. And you can see that it's exactly the Hartree-Fock exchange expression. So basically, this quantity is already in there, okay? So you don't really have to compute it if you start with the Hartree-Fock orbitals and eigenvalue instead of the Konsham one, okay? And here you have the correlation part of the self energy, okay? Which involves those screened two electron integral in purple here, and those RPAs, eigenvalues, and as well the quasi-particle energy or the Konsham orbitals, depending on the type of GW calculation that you're doing, okay? And here again, you have what we call the removal part, okay? And you have basically the addition part. So really you see that you do a convolution between G and W, okay? And in G, there is an addition and a removal part, which gives birth to those two terms, okay? In W, there is an exchange part. That's what gives you this part as well here, okay? And after here, you can, in purple and orange, you can see that's the elements from W, okay? So it's really a combination between the elements of W and the element of G. So you really see that basically that's the only quantities that that you see. So when you do something that is important from a practical point of view is you code GW, you actually don't really need to compute explicitly W, okay? Because what you need is to do an RPA calculation to get that quantity and those quantities here. And you need those epsilon I and epsilon A, okay? But you don't need to compute explicitly W. You need to do it for the beta-salpeter calculation, but not for the GW calculation. Okay, so after you have this very famous Dyson equation that link your starting Grimm's function with the Grimm's function that you're looking for here, including this self-energy, okay? And if you invert this, you can recast that Dyson equation as a nonlinear quasi-particle equation here. So here, let's talk about that equation because that's the equation that you're going to solve explicitly in a computer, okay? So see, here you say see that it's a dynamical, it's an omega dependent equation, okay? So you're looking for, if I put the omega on the other side, you're looking for the root of that expression minus omega, okay? So that thing here is a nonlinear equation, okay? Which means that for one equation, you don't only have one solution. You have not only one zero, you can have many zeros, okay? I'm going to show you a picture after. So so I can show you a picture now actually, okay? So that's basically example the left for H2, okay? Here in red, that's the correlation part, okay, of the cell for the orbit. Just the blue line is omega minus epsilon homo at the artifact level. And the crossing points between the blue curve and the red curve are going to give you the zeros that you're looking for, okay? So that's the quasi-particle energies. And you see that you not only have one solution, you have one here, one there, going to have one here somewhere, okay? Because you continue that red line, you have one here and going to have many of them, okay? So one of them is called what we call the quasi-particle peak, okay? Which has most of the weight, and we're going to talk about how to calculate this weight, and the other solutions, okay, correspond to, okay? So if you don't want to solve that nonlinear equation, which can be annoying, we're going to talk how to solve that in practice. But what you can do, you can linearize the quasi-particle equation. So what you do to do this, you Taylor expand to first order the energy around NP. You get something like this, okay? And you can substitute that equation into this expression, and by doing now you have linear equation, find that PGW just given by expression which are omega independent, so there's one solution of the linearization, and you see that you have appearing renormalization factor, which is spectral weight that we call that as well, is going to be done by the inverse 1 minus derivative of the exchange correlation energy respect to omega evaluated at omega equal epsilon constant. Okay. So it looks scary. Actually, computing derivative is straightforward, right? Because the omega dependency of the self energy is straightforward. So basically, you put the square denominator and put a minus, and basically, you have the derivative of the energy, so it's very easy to calculate, okay? You don't have to compute any other stuff. And if you look at this expression here, you're going to see that Z, so the renormalization factor, is quickly in between 0 and 1, okay? So normally, if you compute the renormalization that respond to each solution, to find one of them, which is very close to 1, okay? It's going to be your particle and most of them that are to have small weights and that responds to satellites. So here you can see that if the derivative is smaller, okay, I'm going to have something close to one, okay, and one something close to one is going to be something close to one, okay. So this renormalization factor okay, is going to be to give you the weight for each of the solution of the nonlinear equation, okay? So what is important to understand, and I'm going to say it again, is that because it's a nonlinear equation, so for each orbital, you're going to have what we call the quasi-particle solution, which is going to gather basically most of the weight, and you're going to have satellites solution, which correspond to smaller weights, okay? And the sum of the weight of all the solution must give you one, okay? It's important. So basically, if you look at that expression here, you see that if the derivative of the self-energy is small, okay? So you're going to have something close to one, okay? And so one over something close to one is going to give you something close to one, okay? So basically, if you're looking at this graph, okay, where the derivative of the self-energy is small, like this here, it means that I'm going to have a large weight. So here I can say that this solution here, okay, is the quasi-particle. And that's the solution I'm going to pick. And those solutions here, you see that when you're going to cross the blue line, every single time you're going to have a derivative which is huge, okay? Because the slope is large. So those ones, you know that they're going to be satellites because the slope is large. And so the weight is going to be small, okay? So here, that's a well-behaved case, okay? So you have no problem. You have a well-defined quasi-particle peak and some satellites, okay? But here, you have problematic cases, like and Xavier talked a little bit about them last time, where you have solutions where, well, it's not quite clear which one is the quasi-particle, okay? And so that's life. It's like this. Sometimes you have problems, and it's not always straightforward to know which one to pick, okay? So that's exactly what I show here. So for the homo orbitals, you have this nice quasi-particle peak. So that's the spectral function. That's the imaginary part of the Green's function. So for the homo orbital here in orange kind of thing, you have a well-defined peak, most of the weight with small satellites here. You can show see them. Same for the green one. You have this nice quasi-particle peak with most of the weight. And here you have small peaks correspond to satellites. And here you have a case for the LUMO plus one, where you have two solutions with similar weights. And in that case, you're going to struggle to know which one is the quasi-particle. And there is actually no real solution for this problem at the moment, okay? Okay, so what time is it now? 54, okay, I'm late. Okay, so now implementation of those methods. So we're going to talk about the different type of methods that we can to be able to define. So we're going to have the well-known G naught, W naught, okay? And two type of partially self-consistent GW scheme. So EVGW, where you're going to do the self-consistent only on the eigenvalues, so on the molecular orbital energy, so on the quasi-particles. And here you're going to do the self-consistent, so that's QSGW, you're going to do it both on the eigenvalues and the orbitals, okay? So that's not a fully self-consistent GW because that self-consistency is only done on the quasi-particle peak, okay? So what we usually call fully self-consistent GW corresponds to doing the full self-consistency, so eigenvalues and orbitals, but not only on the quasi-particle, but on the quasi-particle and the corresponding satellites, okay? That's what we call SCGW. I'm not going to talk about this today because it's much more involved. And if you remember this paper by FIHI Ames, they actually what they do as well. But you need lots of numerical stuff to do it. Okay. Okay. So let's talk about the simplest GW method, which is what I call linearized G naught W naught. Okay. So how am I going to compute this in a computer? I'm going to do this in a computer. So I'm going to perform a constant calculation, okay, or an artificial calculation. It's a type of constant calculation as well. And from it, I'm going to grab the eigenvalues, okay? the coefficient of the constant molecular orbitals and the potential, the exchange correlation potential. Okay, this expression was given here. Okay, so you take the exchange correlation potential and that's just you project that into the basis. Okay, so it's very simple to compute. So the first thing to do. To do this nasty AO to AMO transformation that we talked about a few weeks ago. So I'm going to take my two electron integrals in the basis of the AOs, mu nu lambda sigma, and put them in the basis, in the orbital basis PQRS, knowing that those basis functions are Concham basis functions. When I've done that, using the Concham eigenvalues and the two electron integrals, I can compute, construct my RPA matrices. Okay, so remember the RPA matrices, that's this expression and that expression. Very simple, okay? We'll talk about it after, how to compute them exactly. And after, by doing my usual trick, I can diagonalize those matrices to actually get my RPA eigenvalues and corresponding eigenvectors. Okay, when I have this, I can compute my screen ERIs, okay, PQM, which are given by this very simple expression over here, okay. Not too hard, takes some time, but it's not too hard. And when I have this, I can correct each of the Concham eigenvalues using the self energy, okay. So I can, for each orbital P, okay, that I want to correct, I'm going to compute the element PP of the correlation part of the self energy. Actually, that's the exchange correlation part, sorry, it's not the correlation part. And so I'm going to compute that at omega equal epsilon P Concham, so it's not going to be something dynamical. And I'm going to compute ZP, which uses the derivative of sigma. And by this very simple formula over here, I'm going to be able to correct each of the Concham eigenvalues, and that's going to give me quasi-particle energy at the G naught, W naught level. Okay. So that's what we call linearized G naught, W naught. Okay. And the most expensive part is the RPA calculation, which is going to cost you n to the six. Okay. And so why is that? It's because you're going to have to compute all the eigenvalues and all the eigenvectors at the RPA level, okay? So remember the RPA matrix is proportional to the size O times V, which is proportional to N squared. And when you diagonalize a matrix of size N, it's going to cost you N cubed if you want all the eigenvectors and all the eigenvalues. So if you diagonalize a matrix of size n squared times n squared, it's going to cost you n to the six. Okay. So computing the screening or the RPA eigenvalues and eigenvector is the most time consuming step at the GW calcul at the GW level if you do it like this. If you use the methods of contour deformation developed by in particular Yvan Duchemin and Xavier Blas, you can reduce that scaling. And very recently, for example, they've been able to have a n cube, a cubic implementation of GW using those techniques, where they basically kill that step here. Okay, so with a few tricks, you can improve the scaling of those methods. Okay, and you can do thousands of electrons. So here it's a very basic example on NEON, okay, with the CCPVDZ basis set. So that's my little program. So you see that I've got, it's a one-shot G naught W naught calculation, okay? And so that's the number of the orbitals. Here, that's the R3-Fock eigenvalues. That's the value of the self-energy. That's the renormalization factor. And you see that they're all quite close to one. And that's the corrected value of the molecular orbital energy, okay? What we call the quasi-particle energy. And for each of them, you have the corrected values, okay? So it's quite simple. Huh? There is not much to do, but you have to do it. Okay, so what you can do as well is instead of linearizing the self-energy like we did here, you can also solve the nonlinear quasi-particle equation. So it's exactly the same steps, but here instead of linearizing the quasi-particle solution, you can solve directly that equation. Okay, and so for example, you can do it with Newton methods. Okay, I'm going to show you how it's done after. So there is a different solution to compute that. Okay, that's the only difference. Okay, so if you want to show Newton methods, you go on the Wikipedia page, and there is a very, very, very nice illustration on how Newton. Okay, so you start with a value of your function, and by just using the derivative, you're going to be able to reach the root of your equation. So Newton's method helps you to find the zeros of an equation just with the derivative. So you compute the value of the function at a point, you use the derivative to have a new x value, and you keep going like this until you reach zero with a given accuracy, if you want. So if you want to have a look at the Wikipedia page. There's this very, very nice graph on the right hand side here, which shows you how to do it. It's very, very easy to compute and to code, and you can use it for any equations. If one day you want to find the zero of an equation, use this and you're going to find it most of the time. Okay. Okay. So is the sound okay now, Manu? Yes.
Yes, it is perfect.
Okay, good. Okay. So now we're going to talk about partially self-consistent GW, okay, and the well-known eigenvalue, self-consistent eigenvalue GW, okay, EVGW. So it's roughly the same code as G naught W naught, but you have to add a new loop to be able to do a self-consistent procedure on the quasi-particle energies. Okay. So again, we're going to start by doing a Kohn-Sham calculation to obtain the eigenvalues and the molecular orbitals. You do your AO to AMO transformation, okay? Again, to get the two electron integrals in the AMO basis. You're going to initialize your GW eigenvalues to the value of the Kohn-Sham, set n to zero, and you start your self-consistent procedure. So you compute the RPA matrices using the GW eigenvalues, okay? The current one from the previous iteration, sorry. Okay, so that thing is going to be updated at each cycle. That's important. These quantities here are not going to be updated. Why? Because you're not going to touch the orbitals. You're only going to touch the eigenvalues. That's important. So here again, you compute eigenvalues and eigenvectors at the RPA level. You form your screen ERIs, okay? And based on this, you're going to solve your nonlinear quasi-particle equation for each orbital. For each of them, it's going to give you a new set of quasi-particle energy at iteration n, okay? And so you're going to be able to loop until the difference between the eigenvalues at iteration n and iteration n minus one is close enough to zero, okay? And so after you can stop, okay? So that's very simple. And by doing this, you're going to converge to get usually better quasi-particle energies by doing this very simple self-consistent scheme. So it's not very hard. You just have to make sure you update the right quantities at the right time. So that's what you call EVGW. Any questions so far? Is the algorithm clear or do you want more precision on it? So far so good? No one's complaining?
No, no one complains.
Okay, good. Okay, so that's the output of my little program again. So same type of output. You see that it's EVGAW8. which means I've done 8 iterations to compute my EVGW quasi-particle energies, okay? So here is the same quantities as before, okay? And here you see that at iteration 8, it has converged, and my convergence is below 10 to the minus 5. So I'm happy, and I can compute the homolumo gap at the EVGW level and so on, okay? So it's basically the same, but you iterate your eigenvalues. Okay, now the last member of the family is QSGW. So now we're going to do the self-consistency on the eigenvalues and on the eigenvectors as well. So that's the same idea, okay? So you can perform an Hartree-Fock calculation or a Kohn-Sham calculation, or you can use any set of orbitals, okay? Because normally the result of your calculation is going to be independent on the starting point, okay? So that's important, because you're going to update both the eigenvectors and the eigenvalues, okay? So you set your GW eigenvectors to the Hartree-Fock one, for example, and your eigenvectors here and eigenvalues here, okay? And now we're going to do many steps self-consistently. So you're going to transform your molecular integral from AO to MO, but here you have to do it at every single step. Why? Because you're going to update those matrix coefficients. Okay, this matrix coefficient, you're going to update them. So you're going to have to transform at each iteration your two electron integrals from the AO to the MO basis. It's going to cost you n to the 5. And so that's going to be an expensive step. It's not the most expensive step, but that's an expensive one, okay? So again, here you compute the RPA eigenvectors and eigenvalues. So with your current eigenvalues and two electron integrals, important. Compute your screen ERIs, and based on this, so be careful, here is different. You're going to compute the entire matrix, sigma, so the correlation part of the same family for all P and Q, not only the diagonal like before. Remember, we were only calculating the diagonal of the self energy, but here we're going to calculate all the elements PQ, okay? So the entire matrix. And what you do at the QSGW, because that matrix is a non-Hermitian matrix, usually you symmetrize it, okay, by taking the transpose as well. So that gives you an Hermitian self energy, okay? So you add it to your Fock matrix in the MO basis. You can diagonalize that new Fock-like matrix, okay? So it's a Fock matrix which has been corrected with the correlation part of the self energy. And here you obtain a new set of eigenvalues and a new set of coefficients because you have diagonalized a new Hermitian operator. And when, again, when you are happy, when the difference between two iterations is small, so you can say that you are converged and you can go out of the loop, okay? So that's here you have a convergence on both the eigenvalues here, epsilon, and the coefficients, okay? So at the end of your procedure, you're going to have not Hartree-Fock or Kohn-Sham molecular orbitals, you're going to have QSGW molecular orbitals, okay? And quasi-particle energies associated to those orbitals. So that's probably the more involved self-consistent GW approach. And so I've just showed you the three different type of the most common type of GW calculation that you can do, okay? And so you can code that by yourself. There is nothing wrong and it should work. Okay, so that's again an output file of my little program. So here it's a QSG16. So it tells me that I've spent 16 iterations to converge that calculation. Here is my convergence criteria, which is less than 10 to the minus 5, so I'm happy. 16 iterations, and again, I have a new set of quasi-particle energy, which are different from the GW0 and different from the EVGW, okay? I can compute my Omo-Lumo gap if I want to. And so because I have a new set of orbitals, okay, I can actually calculate the new values of the energy. So because you change the orbitals, it's going to change, the R3 energy is going to change, the exchange energy is going to change, and you can even compute the correlation energy based on different functionals. Okay, we'll talk about it later. And you can calculate a new dipole moment if you want. So here it's neon, so it's zero, which is always good. Okay. Okay, so that's all for GW. There you can compute different type of self-energy. Okay. So remember that GW is a resummation of the bubble diagrams. Okay. So it's a subset of all the diagrams, which works well in the weak correlation regime. But for example, some people have derived, for example, differently. So they use perturbation theory. And so GF2, Green's function, second order of Green's function, use, instead of resuming all the bubble diagram, use just the two diagrams corresponding to second order. So the first bubble and the exchange diagram. Okay. So here you have a double bar integral. Okay. Because you have exchange. And remember, exchange is not here at the GW level. You don't have second order exchange diagram in the GW self-energy. And that can be a massive problem for small systems. For solids, it's not very important, but for molecules, that second order diagram is very important. And for example, if you see in the literature GW plus SOSX, basically that's a modification of the GW self-energy when you try to include that second order exchange diagrams to have better results for molecules. You are, instead of using the bubble diagrams and resum them, you can, for example, resum what we call the ladder diagrams, okay? And that gives you the T matrix approximation, and you can have the expression of the GT self-energy. So Green's function convolution with T matrix. And so basically that's a different type of self-energy, which is supposed to work best for I'm not going to say strongly correlated system because it doesn't work that well, but you can, it's a different type of resummation. You're going to resum the ladder diagram instead of the bubble one. And so you're going to do a particle RPA problem instead of a particle all one, for example. I'm not going to be able to talk about it because I'm running out of time. But basically, in GW, you dress the neutral excitation on your particle to give you a quasi-particle energy, and at the T matrix level, you're going to do a different type of dressing, which corresponds to a different type of diagrams. Okay. So sadly, we can't talk about it today, but maybe one day. Okay. All right, so I think that's it for charge excitations. If you have any questions, might be a good idea to ask them now, because I'm going to talk about beta salpeter now.
Okay, maybe I can ask Titu, if you.
Okay.
I have a question about the Dyson orbitals. Maybe I missed something, but mm-hmm. You actually evaluate them, or in your case, these are just the bare Concham orbitals and you don't get anything more? Or
well, at the QSGW, I think you can call them Dyson.
Okay.
They correspond to a. So it depends, because usually they call the Dyson's orbital, it depends on the definition that you give.
I mean, if you want to compute intensities, how people call it, to get the spectrum, then you need to get the true Dyson orbitals, right? When you write the Lehmann decomposition of the...
Yes, so your QSGW orbitals,
yeah.
You can basically compute a Green's function based on those orbitals and on those quasi-particle energies.
Okay, yeah.
And so by taking the imaginary part of this Green's function, you get your spectrum.
Okay. You see a huge effect on the on these orbitals, I guess?
Well, it depends on the system. Huh?
Okay.
So the problem of those calculations is that they can be hard to converge. I haven't said that, but but they can be much harder to converge than a standard ConCham or artifact calculation.
Mm-hmm.
And why is that? Is because you're doing a quasi-particle calculation, you can have problems between, you can have solutions swapping from one solution to another one. You see?
Okay.
Because you have to choose, every time you solve those equations, you have to choose which one for you is the quasi-particle peak.
Yeah.
And if your self-consistent process switch from one to another one for a given orbital, you're never going to be able to converge.
Okay. Yeah.
So sometimes you can have many, many issues about this. And so you can find some damping schemes to try to soften those problems and so on. But well, at the end of the day, it's never very convincing. But it's because you throw away at each iteration some of the information. And so so unless you do it like fully self-consistently, there is no... I'm not sure there is a valid solution. Well, maybe there is, but it's tricky.
There is another question in the chat box. I don't know. Can you read it, Titu, or should I read?
Yeah, sure. Sure. No, it's fine. Okay. Maybe I just missed that. But I didn't get what we need to see. So you missed it because I think I said it, but I'm going to say it again because it was too fast. Is that if you compute this quantity here, okay, you're going to end up with a non-Hermitian matrix. Because there is no guarantee. If you're looking at this expression and you evaluate it at EGW, actually you get a non-symmetric matrix. And if you get a non-symmetric matrix, you have no guarantee that you're going to get real eigenvalues and real orbitals, okay? And that can be a very, very quickly an issue. So if people have said, actually, we're going to symmetrize it like this. That's an assumption. That's an approximation. And by doing this, you're sure that it's symmetric, and it's sure that you get symmetric real eigenvalues and real eigenvectors. So that's purely practical. I don't think there is any physical motivation behind that choice, to be fair. Does it answer your question? Okay, cool. Okay, so any other questions? Okay, so if not, I'm going to move to neutral excitations. Okay, so we have done a GW. Let's assume we have done a GW calculation, G naught, W naught, EV GW or QS GW. We have our nice quasi-particle energies. We have computed W. And you know that with all those ingredients, we are able to do a Betos-Salpeter calculation, okay? So the problem of Betos-Salpeter BSE is that if you do things with no approximation, you're going to end up with a non-linear problem, okay? Why? It's because your A and B matrix are going to depend on the frequency, and what you actually looking for is actually that frequency as well. So that's a nonlinear problem, okay, which I can have many solutions, and it's very hard to solve numerically. And so that's why people usually do Betos-Salpeter calculation in the static approximation, which correspond to take omega equals zero, okay? So that part does not depend on omega. And so you end up with a linear system with a well-defined number of solutions. And that's because of this that you can only access single excitation at the BSE level, okay? So if you look at the paper by Strignati from 1988, which is actually a real masterpiece, you'll see that he's been able to derive frequency-dependent BSE equations, and at least in theory, you should be able to solve those equations and to find more than single excitations. Okay. So, for example, here that's for diatomic molecule, two electron diatomic molecules in the small basis. And you see that I'm looking at the value of the determinant of the secular equations, if you want, okay? So the zeros of that equation are going to give you the eigenvalues. Okay, so for example, here, the thick black line is the dynamical BSE equations, okay? And the dashed ones, the gray dashed, is basically the static beta-cell-beta solution. So you see that the static solution is going to have one node around here, okay? And that corresponds to your singly excited state, okay? And you see that you have the same type of solution, well, actually you can't see it, but there is the same type of solution for the dynamical equations as well. But you see that in the dynamical framework, you have one more pole here, and you have a pole which corresponds to a double excitations. So what I'm trying to tell you is that by keeping the frequency dependence in the beta-salpeter equations, in practice, or in theory, sorry, you should be able to get more than single excitations. But because we go into the static limit of those equations, we only get the single excitations. You see that, for example, the problem is that you can have troubles with those equations because you see that it's giving a triplet one, which is basically impossible. And that's due to the approximate nature of the BSE equation as well. So dynamical kernels can give you more than static kernels, but you have to be careful because sometimes it gives you spurious excitations. And that's been very well explained by Pina Romanillo in this nice paper. Okay, so if you are interested, have a look at this. Okay, so that's something that I really want to spend a little bit of time on this, because that's really the difference between static and dynamic quantities and why we use dynamical quantities in condensed matter in quantum chemistry and why they are useful. Okay, so for example, you can take the very, very general case where you have a very large linear system, let's say with n solutions, okay? So it basically can be a CI calculation or something similar. And that's something which is linear, okay? So you're going to have to diagonalize H. And so you're going to find an eigenvector C, which corresponds to an eigenvalue omega, okay? You can do it. It might cost you a lot because this linear system can be huge in terms of full CI if you want, for example. And so what you can always do, and that's called the Lovdin partition technique, you can always split this problem into blocks, okay? So I'm going to design to have a block of size N1 by N1, okay? And a block of the size N2 by N2 with a coupling block, little h here. And using the same type of partitioning, I'm going to split my eigenvectors. And it's always going to correspond to the same eigenvalues, of course. So n equal n1 plus n2, everything's cool. Okay. So now if I take row number two, so here with this, so I can write down row number two. And if I invert this, I'm going to be able to write C2 as a function of H2 and H1. And C1, sorry. Okay. And if now I take the first row of my system of equations here, I'm going to get this. And if I substitute my expression for C2 here, in there, I can rewrite this system exactly, that's important, that's exact, like this. So I have H1 tilde, okay, which is a dynamical quantity, so it's nonlinear, and I know that I can find the eigenvalue omega by diagonalizing this new Hamiltonian, which is an effective Hamiltonian, okay. And here I've folded all that information into H1. So what you need to understand here is that H1 is a smaller, small, because H1 is N1 by N1, okay, H1 tilde. It's a smaller non-linear system, but it still has n solutions. Why it still has n solutions? Because writing it like this or like that, it's exactly the same. So you see what I've shown here is that by folding information through the Lovedin partition technique, I've been able to reduce a large linear system into a smaller non-linear system with the same number of solutions. Okay, and that's all the dynamical quantities. By making that operator dynamical or frequency dependent, I've been able to fold information. I get a smaller eigenvalue, eigenproblem, but it's harder to solve because it's now non-linear. Okay. So now what I'm going to do, I'm going to do the usual information. So for example, I'm going to stick the omega equals zero in H1 tilde. Okay. So now what I'm going to have something which is static. So it's frequency independent. And now I've lost N2 solutions because now it's a smaller system of size N1 by N1. And because it's linear, I've lost solutions. Okay. So here, that's exactly why when you do a static Bethe-Salpeter calculation, you can only access single excitations. Because the static approximation made a dynamical quantity static, and so you've lost some of the solutions. Okay, so and that's exactly the same for GW, for Bethe-Salpeter, and for all the embedding techniques or multi-reference couplet cluster technique, and so on. It's always the same problem. Multi-reference perturbation theory, you do exactly the same type of things. So by making something frequency dependent, you can make it smaller, more difficult to solve, but after you can apply the approximation on that term. Okay. So that's how we do it. Okay, and that's exactly what happened at the Bethe-Salpeter level. Is there any questions? Same event for TDFT, exactly. So when you do this adiabatic approximation, that's what you do. TDDFT is an exact theory. You should get all the excitations, singles, doubles, triples, whatever you want. But by making the TDDFT kernel frequency independent, you're going to lose all the higher excitations. Okay, so it's exactly the same. I'm going to talk about it just after. Thank you for this. All right, is there any question on this? Maybe I went a little bit fast. So that's probably the most important slide of the presentation. So in there, there is so many things that you can understand that apply to many fields of physics and chemistry. It's super important. Okay. All right. So now if we have a linear response problem, okay. So a linear response problem, it's always the same structure. You always have this A, B, minus A, minus B, okay? And you need to diagonalize that system, okay? To get your excitations energy and the corresponding eigenvectors if you want, okay? So for example, in TDDFT, in the adiabatic approximation, you have so the diagonal parts of the matrix, which are made of Konsham energies, okay? You have the R3 term in blue here. So that's the R3 response of your orbitals through the electromagnetic excitation, perturbation, sorry. And you have the exchange correlation kernel here, which is made frequency independent, okay? And that's what we call the adiabatic approximation. If that guy was frequency dependent, again, you could access the double excitations and so on. It's possible. Bethe-Salpeter, same. Okay, so you replace that's the same equations. So you replace the Konsham eigenvalues by those GW quasi-particle energies. So basically, what it means that your fundamental gap, so your diagonal approximation, is better. Why? Because you have a better approximation of the fundamental gap compared to the Konsham gap. Okay. So that's the first improvement of Bethe-Salpeter, using GW quasi-particle energies than Konsham energies. Okay, so remember always that even if you have the exact functional, okay, your homo or homo energies can be exact. It can be exact if you have the exact functional, but your LUMO orbital, for example, even if you have the exact functional, is never going to be exact to the exact EA of your system. Okay, it has no physical meaning. So this gap here, a priori, is a bad approximation to the exact one. But here it can be much, much better. You have the same R3 term. And here you're going to replace the exchange correlation kernel by the dynamical screen, by the static screening in that case. Okay. So again, the static screening, remember that there is an exchange part, this guy, the R3-Fock exchange. Okay. So you have 100% of exact exchange in beta salpeter. And the correlation, okay, that here you mimic with your correlation kernel given by your chosen functional, is given by the correlation of coming from the screening, okay, the static one in that case. Okay. So basically, here you can see that you can see beta salpeter as a TD-EDFT calculation when you have used GW quasi-particle instead of Kunshan energies. You have 100% of R3-Fock exchange, and you have replaced your correlation functional by the correlation part of the dynamically screened Coulomb potential coming from your GW calculation. So that comes from GW. Okay. So that's it. So your code for this and your code for that is going to be basically the same. So you have a very nice connection between TD-DFT and beta salpeter. In DFT, you use the density, one-point density. Here we use the two-point Green's function, and they are connected. The diagonal of G is the density. In TD-DFT, you have a two-point susceptibility, which is the derivative of rho with respect to the external potential. And here you have a four-point susceptibility, and they link together. Basically, the diagonal of L is the two-point susceptibility. You have a two-point kernel in TD-DFT. Well, you have a four-point kernel in BSE. So as said by Francesco and Matteo last time, there is more flexibility in the beta salpeter formalism, okay? And if you are interested by dynamical correction at the BSE level, well, you can have a look at that paper and you can talk to Xavier as well, okay? Beta salpeter in a computer. Not very hard, okay? Especially if you have done TD-DFT before, or TD-R3-Fock or CIS and so on. So you do your GW calculation, so G0W0, EVGW or QSGW, depends on what you want to do. You calculate your static screening. So now that you're doing your BSE calculation, you need to compute explicitly that screening. It has to be static, okay? So at omega equals zero. You construct your BSC matrices A and B, and you do your usual diagonalization to get the beta salpeter eigenvalues and optionally the eigenvectors if you want to do something with them. Okay, they don't have to be done. So normally you are only interested to the lowest eigenvalues. So usually you can use the Davidson diagonalization subroutine. And so these steps, usually if you don't do it right, it can cost you only n to the four. So that's the same cost as a TD-DFT calculation. So if you do things right, and I'm not saying I'm doing it, but if you do things right, your beta salpeter scaling is the same as your TD-DFT scaling. And so basically, like roughly speaking, say that normally, you can pretend having at the BSE level, you can basically have the result as good as the best TD-DFT result. So the result that you've got with the best functional, if you want. Okay, that's usually what we say. So what is nice with beta salpeter is that you don't have to choose. You don't have to know which functional to choose for your system. Okay. Of course, if you have strong correlation and so on, it's not going to work. It's important to know that as well. Okay, but for weakly correlated system like molecules and so on, usually it's going to work. Charge transfer state, it works. Okay, so why? Because there is 100% of exact exchange. Okay, any questions so far? 59, we lost 4. Okay, so just to show you that if you code BSE, you can code many things because a linear response problem is very, very general. So for example, if you take your BSE equations and you change the GW eigenvalues by the R3-Fock 1 and you remove the correlation part of the screening, you end up with the TD-HF equations, okay? Which is also known as RPA with exchange, RPAX, okay? And if you take the TD-HF expression and you do the time Dankov approximation, so you set B equals zero, okay? This is wrong, sorry. So if you do the time Dankov approximation, you end up with the CIS equations, okay? So all those methods are connected, and depending on the different ingredient that you put in your equations, in your linear response problem, you're going to end up with different type of formalism. So basically a linear response code should be a black box where you just give exactly the ingredients that you want to get the right methods, okay? So there is usually this very nice little diagrams and connection between methods, okay? So if you take R3-Fock, and you change the exchange R3-Fock potential by the Concham local exchange correlation potential, you get DFT. If you do CI on top of R3-Fock, you get CIS. If you do linear response, you do TDHF. If you set B to zero, you go back to CIS. If you TDHF, if you change the exchange R3-Fock, the non-local R3-Fock exchange potential by the local Concham exchange correlation potential, you end up with TDDFT, okay? If you put B to zero, you go to TDA, knowing that it's not equivalent to the CI on top of DFT. Be careful. Okay? So they're all connected to each other. So normally, if you want to do a linear response calculations, okay? So I might actually skip this, but what time is it? I might actually skip this because I want to talk about computing correlation energy. Okay, so here is just how to compute the A matrix for singlet states. So it's not very hard. You have to do a double loop on the single excitations, okay? So it's important to understand that the matrix A is of size OV times OV, okay? But it's not very hard, so I'll leave it here. Okay, so properties, that's important. So you might want to compute something else than just the excitations energies. So for example, you can compute the oscillator strength, which are linked to the experimental intensities of your transitions, okay? And so to do this, you have to compute that oscillator strength, which is basically given by the sum of the square of the transition dipoles in each Cartesian directions, okay? And these guys, if you do BSE or TDHF or TDDFT and all the same expressions, basically what you need is that bunch of one electron integrals, okay, of the operator X, if you want the X component, and you just multiply it by those eigenvectors, okay? So if you want properties, you have to compute the eigenvectors. And if you have this, you can compute the oscillator strength, and you can see. You can know if a transition is allowed or not allowed, if the intensity can be large or small. It can be important if you want to compare to experiments. Okay. Monitoring possible spin contamination. Okay. If you have a open shell system, okay, your reference state, if it's a UHF state, might be spin contaminated. Okay. So you can compute the expectation value of the spin operator squared, which is usually what you compute to make sure that your state is a singlet or a triplet state or a doublet or whatever you want, okay? So that's the way of doing things. So this expression is quite messy, but I've put the ref where you can find it, okay? So that's usually what you compute. So here, for example, is a small output file from the little program Quack. And so you see that if I do a BAC calculation on water, CCPVDZ, I get something like this. So I get, you have a first excitation 8.4 EV. The oscillator strength is 0.0255, and that's a singlet, S square equals zero. And the transition corresponds to a transition from mostly orbital 5 to orbital 6. Okay, so homolumo. You have the second one here, and you have the same information. So that's, so it's not allowed. So the oscillator strength is zero, so you're not going to observe it experimentally in different set of orbitals, and you can keep going like this, higher and higher in energy, okay? And this one, I'm not too sure what it is. Might be the triplet ones. Ah, yeah, that's triplets. So S square equal two. So you see that for triplet states, the oscillator strength is always zero, okay? Because there are symmetry, spin symmetry not allowed. And you can see it from here because if it's a triplet state, I and A are going to have different spin. So when you're going to integrate over the spin here, you're going to end up having zero. So if you don't have a spin orbit in your spin orbit term in your Hamiltonian, a priori it's always going to be zero. Of course, experimentally it's never exactly zero, but in the computer it's going to be exactly zero if you don't have spin orbit terms. Okay. You can do spin flip. You can apply the spin flip formalism for open shell system, or if you want to access double excitations. And so, for example, that's a very small example where, for example, it's H2 here. So at the spin flip BAC at G not W not level. So if you look at the solid lines, that's EOMCCSD. So that's exact for H2. And if you look at the dotted line, so for example, this one, I know it's not very easy to show, you see that BAC doesn't see the double excitations. Here, that's a double excitation in H2, okay? And static BAC cannot see it, okay? And if you do the spin flip one, well, actually, you can access that double excitation. So how do you do this? It's very easy. So instead of doing a BAC calculation starting from the ground state, you start from the triplet state, okay? And from the triplet state, you can do a spin flip excitation and you get the doubly excited state. But you can do also a spin flip de-excitation to get the ground state. And the double excitations is going to be given by the difference between this excitation's energy and this excitation's energy. So if you do a spin flip calculation, you're going to find a negative excitation or de-excitation is going to be to correspond to the de-excitation from the triplet state to the singlet ground state. And you're going to find, for example, there. So that's a singlet, that's a triplet. Here you're going to find an excitation to the de-excited states. Okay. And by taking the difference between that excitation and that excitations, you're going to end up with an estimation of the double excitation from the ground state to the double excited state. Okay, so that's a very usual formalism at the couplet cluster level, for example. Any questions so far? I think I'm done with beta salpeter. So I finish here, or I talk a little bit about correlation energy. Manu, what do you think?
I don't know. I had a question about the spin flip thing. So is it more a trick, or you think there's some foundation for this?
Well, so you can do a linear response calculation from any reference.
Yeah.
It's completely general. And so by choosing wisely your reference, you can only access single excitations, okay?
Yeah.
So it's totally natural to do this.
Yeah, you start from what you want. Yeah, okay.
Yeah, you start from what you want.
empty way, but okay, yeah.
So the good thing here is that converging to the ground state and to the first triplet state, it's easy. Mm-hmm. So after doing your calculation to get the doubly excited state, it's not too hard. Mind you can't access all the doubly excited states here because it's highly dependent on the triplet state that you use as reference.
Yeah.
So, but that's a trick that has been popularized by Anna Krylov, and it's been used in ADC, in couplet cluster, in TDDFT as well, of course, in many, many different scenarios.
Yeah, it's just anyway, DFT is just a starting point in this approach anyway, right? So exactly. It's a better, yeah, okay. Yeah. Well, I think, I mean, I would not mind seeing what you can tell us about the correlation energy. I mean, you have 15 minutes left, so.
Okay, so I'll talk about correlation energy. Okay, cool. So there is a few different options to compute correlation energies, and so energies at the GW or BSC level. So I'm going to talk. It's not a complete list because you can, there is other things and so on, but let's say that's the mainstream of these ones. So what you can usually do is to compute at the GW level using RPA, you can compute an estimate of the correlation energy of the system. It's an estimate, huh? It's not exact at all. And so that's using what the plasmon formula or the trace formula, which corresponds to taking half of the difference between your eigenvalues and the corresponding TDA eigenvalues. Okay, so that's a very well-known trick where you can actually compute the correlation this way. So if you use the invariance of the trace with respect to the unitary transformation, you can recast the sum of the TDA excitations energies as the trace of A. So basically what you do is usually you compute all your RPA excitations energy and you subtract the trace of the A matrix so that you don't have to compute anything else, okay? So that's one way. There is also what we call the Galitzky-Migdal functional, which is very well known in condensed matter, less well known in quantum chemistry. It's not a super accurate functional if you don't use fully self-consistent GW. Correct me if I'm wrong, but I think that's a true statement. And so what is becoming famous in quantum chemistry though is to use the adiabatic connection fluctuation dissipation theorem at the BSC level to compute the correlation energy. And why is that? It's because it has been shown to be fairly accurate actually. And so so it's more expensive, of course, but it gives very good results. And so how do you do it is by actually integrating from 0 to 1, the trace of Kp lambda, okay? So I'm going to tell you what are all those quantities. So what you're doing is that you're doing an integration along what you call an adiabatic connection path, okay? So here, lambda is the strength of the electron-electron interaction, okay? And so what I'm telling you here is that I'm telling you that I need to do a summation of a quantity basically from lambda equals 0, and lambda equals 0 corresponds to a non-interacting system, okay, to lambda equals 1, which corresponds to the physical system in full interaction, okay? So you understand here that if I do this, and usually I'm doing to do it numerically using a quadrature rule, okay, like we talked about few weeks ago for DFT, I'm going to do a summation and I'm going to have to do calculation at different value of lambda, okay? So basically I'm going to do different calculation for different lambda and each value of lambda is going to correspond to a different system, okay? So that's very similar to, it's coming from the formalism at the DFT level, known as adiabatic connection, where you connect the Kunshan system at lambda equal 0 to the physical system at lambda equal 1. And normally you are supposed to do that at fixed density, okay? The one electron density shouldn't change from lambda equal 0 to lambda equal 1 because the Kunshan system is supposed to have the same density as the fully interacting system. Okay, so that's the same idea here. So K is called the interaction kernel. So it's given by very similar formula. So it's basically the same type of linear response matrices, but there is no diagonal. So there is not this energy difference of molecular orbital energies. Okay, and here P is the correlation part of the two electron density matrix that you can define via the X and Y vectors at the linear response level of theory. Okay, so basically what I'm telling you here, so lambda equal one in that case, actually here and there, sorry, mistake. So what you need to do basically here, you need to be able to compute this correlation part of the two electron, two particle density matrix at various lambda values, okay? Okay, and that's what we do. Okay, so here, because we are going to do a numerical integration, we're going to use a quadrature rule. And here, because we do an integration from zero to one, it's very, very common to use what we call a Gauss-Legendre Gauss-Legendre quadrature rule, okay? So I didn't tell you too much about quadrature rules last time, but remember that it's based on the theory of orthogonal polynomials. And basically, when you want to integrate a function f, okay, one dimensional, it's important. And if you have a weight function w of x, and this function can be different type of function, one, like in our case, one over the square root of something, exponential minus x squared, x alpha exponential minus x, and so on. Okay, depending on the shape of the integrand and the interval that you're going to integrate on, you're going to use different type of weights and different type of roots. Okay, and so that's all the type of Gauss quadrature that you can find very, very so have a look at the Wikipedia page, it's very well made. Depending on the shape of your integrand, you can define a different set of weights and roots, and actually those quadrature are defined to, so quadrature rule, okay? So it's a Gauss, it's a rule constructed to yield exact result for polynomial up to a 2k minus one with a suitable choice of roots and weights, okay? Those quadrature rules are designed to integrate exactly polynomials up to degree 2k minus one with k number of points, okay? So if your x looks like a polynomial and w of x look like a function like this, you're going to win because are exactly designed to integrate exactly those type of functions. That's the point of the Gaussian quadrature rule, okay? So it's, if you do integration, numerical integration, it's always nice to look at the form of your function and how does it look like, okay? Because if you know exactly the interval and the shape of your function, you might be able to find a quadrature rule which works very well for your purpose, okay? So remember this. So the ACFDT, the adiabatic connection formula, you can use it not only at the BSE level, you can use it at the RPA level and the RPAX level as well, okay? So here you're going to replace the A and B elements. So here you need to find X and Y, which means you're going to have to do a linear response calculation. So at the RPA level is given by this, you see that you have this value of lambda here, which scales the two interaction between your electron. And at the RPA level, what is nice is that you can see that you can actually compute that integral exactly analytically, and it gives you back that trace or plasmon formula that we talked about before, okay? So at the RPA level, no need to do that numerical integration. You can actually do it analytically and you get exactly this. Actually, it can be very useful because you can check the quality of your numerical integration by computing this and computing that, okay? If they don't match, you probably have a problem with your numerical integration. So it's very useful. You can do it at the RPAX level. So the elements are slightly different. You see that you have those exchange elements here. And here you can do again that adiabatic connection integration here. And here it's not equal to the same thing, okay? So that's something that has been very well explained by Anjan and co-workers. And if you add exchange in your interaction kernel, so here, okay, if you add exchange, actually you can show that it's almost, it's exactly equal to this. But if you don't have exchange in your kernel, it's not equal to this, okay? So be careful. At the BSE level, you can do it as well. So of course, you cannot do it analytically in that case, okay? You have to do the numerical integration. And so you have to compute for various value of lambda, you have to compute your beta salpeter eigenvalues and eigenvectors. And you have to do that for various lambda values and iterate after, okay? So the procedure is very, very, very typical. 3 minutes, perfect. So you do a GW calculation, okay? At lambda equal one, it's important. You get your Gauss-Legendre weights and roots, WK and lambda K, okay? So you have to choose K, it's very important, the number of points that you're going to use. You set your correlation energy to zero. And for each quadrature weights or roots, what you're going to do, you're going to compute your static screening at lambda k, okay? You're going to perform a BSE calculation at lambda equal lambda k to get your vectors, okay? So that's a O to the n6 step done many times because you need all the eigenvectors and all the eigenvalues. You compute your two particle density matrix, P, and you just accumulate that quantity in EC. And when you've done it for all points, you have the final answer of your correlation energy. Last slide, does it work? Yes, it works actually very well. So here is the ground state potential curve of carbon monoxide in the CCPVQZ. So here, for example, you have in purple here, you have the CC3, so couplet cluster third order here. CCSD is in pink, you see. Okay, so CC3 is more accurate. RPA is there, that's the blue one. So it overestimates, okay, because you're missing exchange. RPAX is underestimates as usual because there is too much, there is not enough correlation, but you have exchange now. And if you do BAC from the G not W not calculation, you see that you basically match CC3. So it works very, very well. It's as accurate as a couplet cluster, third order couplet cluster calculation, which is pretty, pretty nice. And after that, so that's the last slide and I'm done. Thank you very much. And I'd like to thank all the organizers, Francesco, Manu, and all the speakers. And I hope it was clear and entertaining for 2 hours. Thank you very much, everyone.
Thank you very much, Titu. So maybe I can ask you a question, can I?
Sure.
Okay, it's about the statement you made about the Galitsky-Migdal formula. So in principle, the formula is exact, right? It's formally exact if you have the exact self-energy and the exact Green function.
Exactly, yes.
Okay, so I guess there is a connection with the adiabatic connection formalism. So because you said it does not perform so well compared to the adiabatic connection, but
yeah, the problem of Galitsky-Migdal is that it's highly dependent on the quality of G.
Okay.
And so if you do it for G not or EVGW and so on, and so you can have massive variation. And so I've studied that myself a little bit. Been able to get something very accurate with that formula, okay. And so usually it's overshoot the correlation effectively, almost by a factor 2, and actually you can see it because actually it's almost like the direct part of the MP2 energy, but you're actually missing the exchange, and so there is something missing in it. And that's usually what happens at the GW level because you don't have an order exchange diagram. When you do it for small system, it's not very good.
Okay. Okay. Because I was also thinking, like, since you have this product of self-energy and green function, maybe the product, I mean, there should be some kind of balance, because you, I mean, you, there are different levels of approximation. So,
yes. But yeah, so I'm far from being an expert in functional of the Green's function. And so, but at least for molecules, I've played with them a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
So all those functional are supposed to be identical at full self-consistency, but for partially self-consistent scheme, they can differ a lot from one another.
Okay.
So, yeah. So I have lots of stuff to learn from them, and I should do it one day. But yeah, that's all I know from now. They might be wrong, but that's my feeling.
Okay, so, well, I want to thank you again for taking the time to explain us how it works. It's very nice. So thank you so much for this.
Yeah, no problem.
And as you did when you started your lecture, I want to congratulate everyone. I mean, the 53 people who stayed until the end, you made it. Congratulations. So I want to thank everyone. So Francesco, of course, because I mean, we are on YouTube and everything worked always perfectly thanks to him. So Francesco, thank you very much. So thanks also for your messages. And it's been very nice. We got some very kind words from many of you, and all these thank you are raining now in the chat box. So that's very nice. So I hope you enjoyed. I want to thank all the lecturers, of course, because it's been probably the longest summer school ever in the history of science, I guess. But yeah, so we will try to organize this school, not virtual one, a real one next year. We'll see how things are going, because it's getting a bit better, but still, it's not completely under control. So yeah, so thank you, everyone. And Francesco, I don't know if you want to add something or.
No, not really. I will join you in thanking everyone, of course, all the lecturers and participants. And as all the other lecture, this will be put soon on YouTube. There would be probably updates for some lecture notes, some videos, maybe, who knows? In that case, either visit or subscribe and you will see the notification. And we really hope to do it in presential. And who knows if we might think about some hybrid situation for next year, maybe both of them, who knows?
Who knows, yeah, everything is possible now.
Now we are expert, right?
Well, I don't know, but yeah. We can make it looks like. So yeah. Okay, so thanks everyone. Thanks to you again. Perfect finish for the school. So yeah. And well, see you soon somewhere.
Yeah.
Thanks. Bye everyone.
Bye everybody.
Bye bye.